opponents to speak for at the most 10 minutes each, because if you wind up, they have to go to
wind up at 4 p.m. because they want to have a session.
Yeah, so 4 p.m. means about not more than 10 minutes each. So, Professor Vinod Pavralla, please.
Suggest measures to prevent the recurrence of such tragedy, which unfortunately did quite happen. So today I was asked to share the key findings as just told the report is already with you. I won't go into the details of the report. If you have specific questions, we could answer. After the report was submitted, the Vice Chancellor placed it before the Academic Council, which adopted it in total. Subsequently, the Controller of Exams sent out guidelines and some of the key recommendations to all the departments to follow. Much of the report, as you may have seen, is quite banal. It's about academic administration, the routines, systems and procedures for grievance redressal, accountability, transparency, better communication, and so on. But as many people have pointed out to me since then, this was perhaps the first report commissioned by a university that acknowledges some caste discrimination on our campuses. We had not realized how momentous the report may have been at that time. But since then it has got a life of its own, and people are citing it on these lines. There are references in the report to student perceptions of discrimination, caste discrimination specifically. It also makes references to how the committee could not find hard evidence of discrimination in the schools. But what this reference to perceptions and lack of hard evidence perhaps suggests or points to is the insidious ways in which prejudice and discrimination tend to operate, especially in university campuses. I mean, you may not find concrete, visible evidence of somebody having done something because of caste prejudice, but you know, there are subtle and insidious ways which students routinely point out in, you know, ways in which caste discrimination does operate. Therefore, I mean, the committee had made a case for hard systemic changes combined with relatively softer interventions such as mentoring, greater sensitization of faculty and non-teaching staff to issues related to caste, and so on. Basically, what we found was the way in which the PhD program was administered in this particular school to which Senthil belonged put in place a lot of arbitrary procedures. There were shifting goalposts. After students finish their coursework, they are told that the goalpost has now shifted, and even if they get more than 50%, they are declared as not having passed that course because the faculty members have raised the bar after the exam was written. Right? This was something that we had not heard anywhere. This coursework also was being administered almost independently by the school without involving the Controller of Examinations, which is a standard practice. Yeah? And the controller would receive no reports of the coursework being administered, who has passed, who has not passed, and so on. Students during the committee hearings have also told us about how they might be recruited as PhD students, but then find it tough to find guides. In 2006-07, the period around which the committee did its work, there were four Dalit students who were selected in the School of Physics. Two of them left the program because they could not find guides, and two others who stuck on, one of them was Senthil. Yeah. And it created kind of second-class citizens within the school, and there was very strongly felt perceptions among the students that those students who were facing this kind of treatment were Dalit students. The other thing that came up was a lack of communication of rules and procedures, which are often changed temporarily. That information is not given to students. These are not communicated to students in time. For example, in Senthil's case, there was a specific issue about fellowship, which apparently there was a order from the administration which from all accounts Cecilia had never seen. Yeah, which actually was quite a positive sort of a order which could have helped Cecil, you know, get some peace about his anxiety about next month's fellowship. Yeah, he could have been assured of the fellowship if he had seen that order. But he had never seen it. It wasn't put up on the notice boards. There were also issues about the other students having complained about, I think somebody had mentioned it earlier, that even if they perform well in the written exam, the entrance test, they are deliberately given low marks in the interviews so that they can get seats only in the reserve categories. So, I mean, we have heard that repeatedly from different students, and one of the recommendations was that the university follow a double-blind system of evaluation where the student's social background is not known, and also the written test marks are not given to the interview boards. That these things are done independently and then you add them up and form the list. Doctoral committees have been a requirement in the university for almost 10 years now, but at the time when we did the work of the committee, the doctoral committees were not meeting regularly. Many of them were only on paper. Students complained that the committee that needs to meet every semester doesn't quite meet. And we actually felt the doctoral committees are useful in both ways, that it's an accountability mechanism for the students' progress, but it also prevents the students from becoming victims of sort of solitary authority from a supervisor. That there is a doctoral committee that looks at the work of the supervisor, work of the student from time to time. After this recommendation, the academic council made it mandatory for doctoral committees to meet at least once every semester. The double-blind evaluation system has now become the norm. I hope that it's being followed in all the departments. But at least there is such a rule that's been passed by the university. I think some of these administrative procedural things have at least been accepted on paper. But I think it's almost been 8 years since the report was done. There were subsequent suicides. There were a couple of other reports which you know of. It's perhaps time for the university to undertake some kind of an audit of those recommendations and see where we stand. You know, what recommendations have been implemented, what have not been implemented, what difficulties, if any, that departments and schools are facing in implementing these recommendations, and also talk to the students if any of those practices that came up in the report are still in vogue in certain programs. So I have suggested already to the administration to undertake such an audit, and I'm repeating that here. So let me stop there and see if you have questions from the report or any other queries you have. Thank you.
This para 5.9, you suggested a grievance mechanical.
Yes.
Combining students. Was any such committee record?
The time when we did the report,
5.9.
Right. Some schools had grievance committees, which were.
You recommend also students should be there.
Right. I think from what I know, some departments which have grievance redressal mechanisms also have students in them. There are grievance redressal committees I know on campus which don't have students on them. So that particular, I think, should come up in an audit to see how well we have implemented that. But yes, we did recommend that students should be part of the grievance committee.
Thank you.
Thank you.